In a museum parking lot at the Johnson Space Center sits a 363-foot Saturn V rocket, the most powerful machine humanity has ever built, gathering dust instead of exploring the cosmos. This is SA-515. Walk around its base and you'll need 5 minutes just to circle the first stage. Look up at its peak and you're staring at something taller than a 30-story building. This rocket was supposed to carry Apollo 18 to the moon. The crew was selected. The landing site was chosen. The experiments were built and ready to deploy. It never launched. But the reason why isn't aliens or government conspiracies. It's something far more human and far more tragic. This is the story of how humanity's greatest exploration program, at the absolute peak of its scientific capability, was deliberately dismantled and sacrificed. Not because we couldn't reach further, but because we chose not to. History tells you it was just budget cuts, the inevitable end of an expensive program. But the hidden files reveal something darker. The deliberate sacrifice of humanity's greatest exploration effort at the exact moment it reached its scientific peak. This is the story of a ghost mission and what we lost when we abandoned it. Picture yourself in 1970, standing in the vehicle assembly building at Kennedy Space Center. You're an engineer who has spent the last decade perfecting the most sophisticated exploration system ever built. Around you, teams are assembling spacecraft that represent the culmination of everything you've learned. Every failure analyzed, every system refined, every lesson from earlier missions baked into the hardware. This is the moment Apollo was built for. By 1970, NASA had transformed lunar missions from desperate gambles into refined scientific expeditions. The early Apollo missions were about survival. Get there, plant the flag, come home alive. But Apollo 18 was designed as something far more ambitious, a J-class mission, the pinnacle of lunar exploration technology. Think of it as the difference between a tourist snapping photos at the Grand Canyon and a geologist spending a week mapping its deepest secrets. The numbers tell the story. Apollo 18 would spend 3 to 4 days on the lunar surface, not the brief tentative hours of Apollo 11. But enough time to establish a genuine scientific outpost. The crew would conduct 3 separate EVAs, totaling 22 to 24 hours of exploration time. They'd deploy the Apollo Lunar Surface Experiments Package, ALSEP, a sophisticated array of instruments designed to unlock the moon's deepest secrets about its interior structure and environment. Seismometers to detect moonquakes, heat flow experiments to measure the moon's internal temperature, magnetometers to map its magnetic field. These weren't just instruments, they were questions we were asking the universe. And they'd have the lunar rover, an electric car that could travel up to 12 kilometers from the landing site, transforming the mission's reach from a small circle around the lander into genuine exploration. Imagine the difference between being stuck in your backyard versus having a car that lets you explore your entire county. That's what the rover meant for lunar science. The target sites under consideration, Copernicus Crater, Schroeder's Valley with its distinctive Cobra Head volcanic region, or Gassendi Crater, represented scientifically rich terrain that previous missions hadn't reached. These weren't just pretty locations. Copernicus was a relatively young impact crater that could reveal what lay beneath the moon's surface crust. Schroeder's Valley was a massive channel that might hold secrets about ancient volcanic activity. Gassendi sat at the edge of Mare Imbrium, where highland and mare geology collided. Each site was a library of lunar history waiting to be read. The Saturn V rocket designated for this mission, SA-515, represented the culmination of engineering perfection. Stand next to one of its 5 F1 engines, and you're looking at a bell-shaped nozzle 12 feet across, a mechanical flower that could generate 1.5 million pounds of thrust. Together, all 5 engines could produce 7.65 million pounds of thrust, enough force to lift 310,000 pounds all the way to the moon. That's the weight of 40 elephants, accelerated to 25,000 miles per hour, then hurled across 250,000 miles of void. Here's what makes this even more staggering. Launching a Saturn V, required the same immense resources and national coordination as hosting a Super Bowl. Thousands of personnel working in perfect synchronization, months of planning for a single event, total precision required at every level. The difference? One event would thrill the world for an afternoon. The other would advance human knowledge for generations. But there's something you need to understand about what it took to reach this point. At Grumman and North American Rockwell, engineers had just celebrated completing Lunar Module 13 and command and service, Module 115, the last of their kind. These weren't prototypes gathering dust in warehouses. They were flight-ready vehicles, fueled by the pride and expertise of thousands of workers who believed their craftsmanship would reach the moon. Every weld was perfect. Every circuit was tested. Every system had been refined through lessons learned from earlier missions. NASA had finally solved the early problems. The missions were safer than they'd ever been. The science was more sophisticated than anyone had dreamed possible back in 1961 when Kennedy made his promise. Apollo 18 represented the moment when we'd transformed from desperate pioneers into confident explorers, when the moon was no longer a destination, but a laboratory. This was humanity at its finest, building machines that defied physics, asking questions that reached beyond ourselves, pushing forward not because it was easy, but because it was hard. But while engineers perfected their machines, a different kind of countdown had already begun, one that would destroy the program from within. The year was 1970, and America was bleeding money. Vietnam was consuming $2 billion per month, not per year, per month. That's $67 million every single day, vanishing into the jungles of Southeast Asia. Cities were burning. The civil rights movement had exposed deep wounds in American society that required urgent attention and resources. And NASA was asking Congress to fund three more moon missions, each costing between $350 and $450 million in 1972 dollars, to collect more rocks. Do the math. A single Apollo mission cost what you could use to build schools, hospitals, housing projects. That $400 million could fund programs that would directly touch the lives of millions of Americans. Meanwhile, the nightly news showed body bags coming home from Vietnam and protests filling the streets. NASA found itself in an impossible position, defending the indefensible luxury of lunar exploration while the nation was coming apart at the seams. But the real killer wasn't just the cost, it was the apathy. After Apollo 11 won the space race, something terrible happened to public interest. The magic faded. TV networks stopped broadcasting live moonwalks. When Apollo 13 nearly ended in disaster, the world tuned in because death was dramatic. But when Apollo 14 landed safely? Yawn. Been there, done that. The most extraordinary achievement in human history had become routine in less than 2 years. Think about that. We had transformed walking on another world, something that had been fantasy for all of human history until 1969, into background noise by 1971. The been there, done that mentality took hold with breathtaking speed. Inside NASA, the mood was darkening. Internal memos between agency management and the White House expressed growing alarm over escalating costs and vanishing political support. More troubling were the scientific debates brewing within NASA itself. Some researchers were quietly questioning whether additional missions would yield discoveries proportional to their staggering expense. The law of diminishing returns was setting in. Each new rock collection from increasingly remote lunar sites promised incrementally smaller scientific breakthroughs. For the astronauts, this wasn't abstract policy debate. This was their lives. Vance Brand, Don Lind, and Harrison Schmitt were among the astronauts most frequently associated with Apollo 18 in NASA's tentative crew assignments. These were men who had trained for years, sacrificed time with families, dedicated their lives to this moment. They'd studied geology until they could identify rock types at a glance. They'd practiced lunar landings in simulators until the procedures were muscle memory. They'd driven rovers across simulated moonscapes in Earth's most desolate regions. Their mission patches were designed. Their landing site was chosen. And then, one day in September 1970, they were told, "Your mission no longer exists." Don Lynn's story epitomizes the personal devastation. He became known as the unluckiest astronaut in NASA history. Selected for Apollo 18, he watched his moon mission evaporate. Years of preparation, thousands of hours in simulators, geological expeditions across Earth's most lunar-like landscapes, all for a flight that would never launch. He was repeatedly reassigned as program priorities shifted like sand beneath his feet. Just as Apollo 18 finally represented his chance to walk on the moon, the mission was canceled entirely. The decision came swiftly and brutally. In September 1970, NASA didn't just cancel Apollo 18, they terminated Apollo 19 and 20 as well, killing three missions in a single stroke. The announcement was framed as fiscal responsibility, but it was political survival. Politicians had found an easy target for budget cuts, and Apollo's diminishing returns on public enthusiasm made it vulnerable. Here's what made the cancellation particularly cruel. The hardware was already built. The spacecraft existed. The astronauts had trained for years. Engineers at Grumman and North American Rockwell had celebrated completing the last lunar module and command module for Apollo 18, unaware their work would never fly. But the true tragedy wasn't just the canceled missions. It was the deliberate dismantling of capability. NASA didn't just postpone Apollo 18, they destroyed the infrastructure. The production lines that built Saturn V rockets were shut down and dismantled. The teams that had perfected lunar operations were disbanded. The institutional knowledge, the thousand small lessons learned from each mission, was scattered as engineers moved on to other projects or left aerospace entirely. The Saturn V SA-515, the rocket that should have carried Apollo 18 to the moon, became a museum piece. This wasn't a temporary setback. This was NASA making returning to the moon impossibly expensive for generations. By destroying the capability to build Saturn V rockets, by disbanding the teams that knew how to operate them, by letting the supply chains and specialized facilities disappear, they ensured that any future lunar program would have to start from scratch. The cost estimates for Apollo 18 ranged from $350 to $450 million in 1972 dollars, a sum that politicians argued could fund schools, hospitals, and social programs at a time of domestic crisis. They weren't wrong about the nation's needs, but they were making a choice about what kind of species we wanted to be. Don Lind wouldn't fly in space until 1985, on a shuttle mission that couldn't compare to the lunar journey he'd lost. 15 years of waiting. 15 years of watching that Saturn V, SA-515, sit in its museum display like a funeral monument to what could have been. And so, the rocket that should have carried humanity further into the cosmos became a monument to what we gave up. We began with the official story, that Apollo 18 was simply a victim of budget cuts and waning interest. A footnote in history. A canceled mission that nobody remembers. But the hidden files reveal the deeper truth. It was a deliberate choice, a moment when America decided that political expediency mattered more than cosmic ambition. The cancellation of Apollo 18 wasn't just about one mission. It represented the ease with which humanity can abandon its greatest achievements. We had reached the moon. We had perfected the technology. We stood at the peak of our capability, ready to transform lunar exploration from brief visits into sustained scientific discovery. And we walked away. Here's what conspiracy theorists got right. There was a cover-up, but it wasn't about aliens or secret missions. The real cover-up was hiding in plain sight, buried in congressional testimony and budget reports that nobody wanted to read. The boring documents that revealed how we choose what matters, what we're willing to pay for, and what we're willing to abandon when the bill comes due. Today, that Saturn V, SA-515, sits at the Johnson Space Center, lying horizontally in a climate-controlled building. It's a 363-foot monument to unrealized potential, a rocket that could have taken us to the moon. Now a museum piece that reminds us what happens when we choose the immediate over the eternal. You can walk its length, run your hand along its skin, and feel the weight of what we sacrificed. Every piece of hardware is accounted for in the historical record. No secret launches, no missing equipment, just careful documentation of what was built, what flew, and what ended up in museums. The astronauts supposedly lost on a classified lunar mission. Vance Brand went on to fly on Apollo Soyuz and logged three more missions aboard the space shuttle. Don Lind finally made it to space in 1985, becoming a payload specialist and scientist. Harrison Schmitt flew on Apollo 17 instead, the last human to leave footprints in lunar dust. They weren't silenced. They weren't disappeared. They were reassigned, their careers continuing in full view of the public record. The conspiracy wasn't a secret moon base or hostile extraterrestrials. It was the mundane machinery of government choosing between competing priorities, between lunar exploration and social programs, between tomorrow's dreams and today's crises. This story matters now more than ever. Apollo 18's cancellation remains a case study in balancing ambition with sustainability, directly shaping NASA's cautious approach to Artemis and modern lunar programs. Today's mission planners emphasize international cooperation, commercial partnerships, and modular exploration architectures. Lessons learned from watching Apollo's peak capability sacrificed on the altar of short-term thinking. The question facing us isn't whether aliens are real. It's whether we'll make the same choices our predecessors made in 1970. Whether we'll once again trade the stars for immediate political expediency. Because the real secret of Apollo 18 wasn't hidden in classified files or buried on the lunar surface. It was written in budget memos and political speeches. The mundane documents that killed humanity's greatest adventure. We didn't abandon the moon because of what we found there. We abandoned it because we stopped looking up. Apollo 18 never flew, but its ghost haunts every decision we make about space exploration today. Because the real question wasn't whether we could keep going to the moon, it's whether we have the courage to finish what we started, or if we'll keep building rockets that never leave the ground. The choice, as always, is ours. If you enjoyed this story, hit subscribe for more stories where history, technology, and human ambition collide. Thanks for watching.